know, we're talking about type of relationships, and that itself is a very exciting and very broad topic, right? How are two objects related? And I mentioned in the last class, or last time we were going through this talk, that you have a variety of form of relationship, like this linguistic relationship, referential links, structure link, causal links, relational links. These are there is a classification, and there are multiple classifications. This is adapted from Ramesh Jain's talk. He used this kind of classification. And in the, you know, there are even more complex relationships. For example, relationship between living organisms. So antagonism, something, you know, exploitation, predation. These are all the examples that you see in, you know, either biology or evolutionary science or social sciences. There are other relationships between the humans. And again, the different perspective, you can talk about familial relationships, business relationships, whatever, right? So very broad topic. Now, just look at one example kind of things we often come, you know, across in information systems and data on the web and such, is that, you know, you have here a schema. You can see, and kind of see, PhD student is advised by a researcher who publishes paper, that kind of stuff, right? And this can be assistant professor, professor, whatever. And then here you see some instance of that, right? So your instance here, Karthik Gomardhan, this is, you know, we made that when Karthik was attending a Google I/O event, and that there are spatiotemporal information there. He was at Moscone Center in San Francisco, and that, you know, there's some other things here. And one of the interesting observations you need to note is that some of these may come from a particular data source. For example, a web page or a document. Others may come from some other source. For example, when he's attending this Google I/O event at Moscone Center, you get this data. But this data is probably old. That Amishad is an advisor of Karthik Ravak Gomardhan. That it comes from other place. Maybe it is even not documented. Maybe there is a verbal agreement between the two. Or maybe they had done paperwork and, you know, department, but that's not documented anywhere. Or maybe it is on his web page or my web page, right? So it can come from multiple sources, right? One aspect, there are a number of aspects in this paper about identifying relationship and then representing that relationship, then discovering that relationship, then exploiting the relationship. There's a whole life cycle of the relationships. So here I'm talking about identifying a represent relationship where relationship may be implicit. So statistical representation that of interaction with an entity, something that is mined, let's say, from the data. So nothing that explicitly says when you buy egg, when you buy milk, you would buy egg. That mean nothing, no explicit rule per se, but you may be mining database and identifying the relationship, right? Sometimes it is co-occurrence of terms in the same cluster, sometimes there is that cluster. In many ways, this the representation there implies that these two things are related. Or data implies that the two things are related. Linking one document to another document via hyperlink is establishing relationship, because you're trying to convey that something in this document relates to something in the other document.
Question. So, Dr. Sheth, you said that, for example, Google, they are not using the industry, academia standards, or web, semantic web standards to represent their knowledge graph, right? Mm-hmm. So how are they doing such kind of complex relationship? How they are capturing it?
So, this goes back to, again, in fact, the same year, I think 2008, I also gave a keynote at Asian Semantic Web Conference. Guha came there, Ramnath Guha, who is also, you know, co-track chair with me on www this year, or Semantics and Knowledge Track. And he was at Google then, I mean, and we were discussing things. And so he told me that they are not using RDF. And general information he shared with me is the same reason, basically, in Tali and Simagics, we did have all these relations. Relations are fundamental to what we did, right? And I'll have some more slides on that. In those days, you're talking about, let's say, 2010, at least, the RDF implementations were not robust. They could not store very large amount of data, and particularly they would not process the data adequately. So I remember going to, there is a conference series called Semantic Technology Conference, which is an industry, you can call it as an industry counterpart of the research conferences like ISWC or ESWC. And for the first three, at least, or four of them when I went there, one of the biggest discussion would be that relational databases, semantic web databases, meaning Sparkle, RDF databases, and Sparkle query processing RDF databases, don't scale. Especially when you have billion, triples and higher. Things have changed, essentially. So the paper that, and very recently rather, the paper that Wien just submitted talks about some of the largest data sets that are publicly available. Several billion triples size. But those things don't scale, in the trend, you know, let's say it would, her performance of her algorithms using singular properties many times faster than the Oracle's performance on the same queries. Okay. So basically it was, in general, a rule of thumb is that expressiveness always comes at the cost of performance. Until people figure out some way to deal with, give the performance that applications need, while still supporting the expressiveness you need also, right? So initially what would happen is that people, even in my company, in my our thing, we did not use RDF. Of course, we are way earlier than, we are talking about 2008-2009, we are talking about 2000. And so what basically happens is that it is storing the data in relational database because they can perform, they can scale. There are, cluster-based implementation, all that kind of stuff. There are indexing strategies. And that you would get the artifact of or the idea of relationships by special means. Okay. So it will be basically a, you know, implementation hack as to how you get the what happened. This is my understanding, and not I won't claim to be I think it is accurate, but I'm not totally certain about it. Is that people still have figured out graph implementations that are graph databases that are far more performing and then RDF databases, right? So RDF has a graph interpretation, right? And RDF does have this, you know, couple of different things, Turtle and such. But RDF has additional major burden that all the data is web-based. So you have namespaces, right? And if you look at the amount of data, amount of digital footprint there is, amount of, the size of documents that it is generating is likely much larger than corresponding equivalent or nearly equivalent representation in graph databases. Except that RDF data, anytime you take, is a web base, and you can reference it globally. In a graph database, there is no such implication reference globally. So if Google wants to use RDF but is never exploiting the public aspect of the data, the web accessibility of the data, that comes with URI usage in there, and namespace and other things. Then it does not pay that extra cost necessary for that, right?
But in terms of commercializing your products and so on, you won't be using, you know, LOD. Unless you are just plugging it into a product of yours.
Well, actually, recently, for instance, Oregon, what the usage is absolutely true, escapability always was an issue in semantic web because big companies like Oracle, which provide powerful database management system, didn't support RDF. But recently, for instance, Oracle supports RDF, okay, and it's quite fast. But actually, some years ago, many of big data sets in LOD, they didn't convert the relational database actually to RDF. They had actually middleware that this conversion was done on the fly. And actually, once you send a Sparkle query, a Sparkle query was converted to SQL and then run on over the databases.
I think
SQL is very fast, Sparkle is quite slow.
But that, I think I got from Dr. Shit that he's talking about why would I embrace some technology that I'm not gonna really use it, like URIs, right?
Yeah.
Like for Google.
So what happens is that Google does not, you know,
yes.
Google's data, metadata, knowledge graph is not public.
Exactly.
And it does not have to have an endpoint on the web, and it doesn't have to. So why would they, undertake that? My own, Thalissi Magic's freedom.
And
it's a product. And all my ontology, or all the ontologies, or the work model, and all the metadata is, our own. And we're not going to publish it and give it to anybody, and it doesn't have to be. That is that. And whilst it is true, Oracle has had RDF support for quite some time. Okay, it's at least 6, 7, 8 years. But and in fact, one of our, our alumnus, Matt Perry, is a key member of Oracle's first RDF team, and then Oracle's partial database also implemented GeoSparkle. His work also implemented based on RDF kind of stuff. So Oracle, and then there are other vendors that have been developing, and they're constantly fighting the scale and improving every time, right? That still did not come any, for, so they still were struggling with billions, and then you talk about Google, you talk about some things, they will have trillions, right? So that's, they just did not scale. There's other analogy I'll give you. This is not here, but in our own spirit of learning, slide tracking, in our own Twitter system, we were using MongoDB, considered to be relatively fast, right? Compared to our relational stores, no SQL databases are significantly fast, and yet at even Twitter scale, it simply did not scale. So we were doing, there is a part of module that just was totally slowing down. Everything else in Twitter was sub-second, millisecond time frame, and this one was taking a long time. So then it has gone to that main memory thing that I had shared on our, community, right? You notice that. And that is where, so that's how they are going. So same way, people created for the application purpose main memory versions of the, for solving the problem, right? So important thing is that the data that these all guys had, had relationship as very important, but going RDF route would have been the most logical, open web-centric thing, as that cannot perform, or as that some parts of that are not needed, companies would take the route of not, going with a homegrown solution. So it may be implemented on a big table, and so on and so forth, right? If you have you know, so the generality is not there, but it's not necessary because you know the application that would use the data in a very specific way.
But my notice here is sometimes the semantic web researchers, they sell all the field with these technologies, you know what I mean? Like, it doesn't mean that, for example, Google are not doing semantic web, but they're not doing this kind of
precisely
stuff.
Right. Precisely right. So I have always made the distinction that I'm after semantics and not necessarily semantic web technologies and standards. So that's why Tali and Bokken Semantics did not use RDF. I have talked about my research paper published originally in 2006 and 2008, even before 1998, before I started Tali, where I didn't use RDF. Okay, 2008 RDF paper, you know, I'll show you, very interesting, MREF. So the thing for me, the power is explicitly thinking about relationship, and as a first class object, not so much as to whether I realize that it through RDF syntax or through some graph representation.
Just to add something to what you just said, so I remember in the triple AI paper that you and Sanjaya and Sujan submitted, you were mentioning that RDF is not a good way to represent data because the lack of emotion and sentiment that it cannot capture. So can you explain what you mean?
I don't remember that right now. So we can do this offline. We have to discuss that, right? That doesn't make sense to me per se. I mean, it's at least for metadata, I can represent RDF also. But okay. So you talk about implicit relationship, right? And then there are, of course, explicit linguistic relationship, and again different types of, such as in this case, explicit linguistic relationship. So he beat Randy Johnson, converted into triple. Willis beat Randy Johnson, right? So, or there may be formal relationships, right? With subsumption and partonomy, and others where I can give formal syntax. Although partonomy syntax is complicated, there are at least 7 different interpretation of part of. That is not the problem with either hierarchy or subsumption. There's only one subsumption, but the multiple of part of. So it's, you know, the relation type of part of is very complex. In fact, I was just thinking of an old colleague, somebody I've done some work with and published, James Geller. He is a professor at NGIT. His PhD thesis was on modeling partonomy. Then there are domain-specific versus domain-independent relationships. So you have example of domain-independent relationships like time, space, location. You can also think about location-based relationships that are domain-specific. But then there are complex entity relationships that I'll come to later. Why is this a hard problem? So are objects and entities equal or the same? This I was talking earlier. Remember? In semantics, when you talk about meaning, very fundamental issue will, after you break down the problem and all that, you would often come to the most fundamental issue that are the two objects same or different? And in fact, there's some very good discussions, including, I think, there's a write-up by Patrick Hayes. Pat Hayes, very well known, a researcher coming from more logic and other background. And he has talked about semantics, meanings of same as. So there are multiple, and same as a construct in our, let's say, can be misused or used for many different interpretations. You remember I was talking about same as, I don't know if you remember, I don't know if I talked in this class about the example that when I was working for this Belcore, which is a telephone company in those days, we were modeling a switch, telephone switch, that occurs in the central office. It's usually a windowless building where all the wires, telephone wires, landline, go, and they terminate there. And there's a rack. And then the rack, behind the rack is a switch that connects to other rack. So physical connection would get made. Right? That's how the landlines work. Even, I believe, wireless data also goes through that. The part that is different between wire and wireless is the loop part. So telephone circuitry has three part tradition. The loop, which is from your equipment. This is the equipment, and this is the equipment. From your equipment, meaning telephone, to the central office is loop. Then it terminates in the loop, and then there is a switch which connects one part of the circuit to another part of the other circuit. Then all of that data goes in on trunks. Earlier, the trunks used to be big data pipes, T1 lines, they were copper lines, and then they were all replaced by fiber. So, first fiber came between central offices, then fiber came even outside of the central office. But this is where much of the huge amount of data gets. So, when the loop terminates, one application thinks about the switch from one view, another thinks about the switch from another view. Now, if I'm talking about, is this switch in this database same as the switch in this other database, because they have the same ID, possibly. Physically, it may be the same, but the part of the switch that is modeled in this database is different than this database. You understand? Now, when you use same as, there is not enough metadata to see exactly what context, what is covered in the sameness. Right? So, that's a challenge. Right? Talking about things being exactly the same is different. It may be the same as for a particular purpose, but not in a physical thing. Huh? So, you can substitute the thing, oh, that's the same as this thing, you can use that. Right? So, let's say there are two artificial sweeteners. Oh, this one is same as that. You say that. Physically, they're not the same as in this case. And yet, you will say same as. In other case, logically, they're not same, and yet you will say same as. Right? So, that is only about equality. You're trying to make assertion that the two things are same. When you now know that two things are not same, all the hell breaks loose. Because then they can be not same as, in many, many different ways. And the vocabulary and models for things not being same as is very complicated or very diverse. Okay, so how well are they represented? Let us talk about it. So first of all, they can be statistical representation of interactions between entities, co-occurrence of terms in the same cluster, tag cloud, right? There may be formal, assertional, or social consensus way. Like in ontological modeling, what is it? Social consensus based thing that these are the same as. Nothing else. Right? Sometimes you may find the statistical pattern that indicates that they may be same, and then you are asserting, okay, I have now, human looks at the statistical pattern saying, oh, this seems to be the same, and then you are asserting this is the same as. Okay. For example, there are two different brands of milk on the in Myers. And you figure out statistically think that the behavior in the pattern of buying of this brand of milk and this brand of milk is same. And now you want to model milk in your database. Then you can say, oh, this is same as, you know, at least in the context of milk. Not the product, but the functionality. Okay. Yes.
So like I said, it's a great point that you pointed out. Actually, the same discussion was for equivalent classes, because always a class might not be equivalent exactly to another class. So that's why Scott's vocabulary came out that says that, for instance, these two classes, define a kind of hierarchy over equivalent, like broader, narrower, it's related to each other, might be not exactly equivalent, but related to, or, and I think for the same as, because same as is utilized in the instance level, a kind of same vocabulary, like a scope can be defined. To capture both contexts and how same, how much same as they are.
So yes and no. India, SCoS can give you a representation framework for asserting, but the assertion may not be itself is not something you can make it likely and make and can would not be necessarily perfect. Let me just give you this is example in my mind. I just skipped it. It came and disappeared. You're talking about, oh yeah, so the example is the following. I want to simply assert something as an adult.
As
a? Adult.
Okay.
Now, I am given a database. But really, if your modeling is just adult, your concept, or if you're modeling a concept of adult, then you can interpret multiple definitions of adult and call it an adult. So adult as in person who can buy alcohol versus person, adult as in person who can service in military versus adult who can drive versus adult as in one who can legally, you know, sign the document, right? So, it still is a human decision whether there is one adult or multiple adults. And SCoS and such, you know, things can give you the vehicles for representing it, but it doesn't solve the problem of actually finding, understanding, extracting, and those kinds of stuff.
Yeah.
Right? So, and when that is not applied right, then you'll end up making a mistake. Once, for example, you read, you know, you tell a programmer, here's the data, instance data, and tell me all the people who are adult, and then put into this other database where it's a table for adults. And he goes and writes the things, and he uses adult equal to age of this or that or that, or in fact, he takes the highest age possible, lowest age possible, or highest age possible. He gets the database. Now you're given the database adult. Now there's no way you can figure out, unless you know the code and the original data, to say whether the, you know, which definition of adult he used, unless he had captured into his model itself. Right? So these are, you know, very, these are semantic issues. And you have to distinguish between semantic issues and semantic representation and standard issues. Okay. Moving on, so then there is, you know, formal assertions, and then there are powerful, you know, so the partial, probabilistic, and fuzzy match. Representation of these in first causal order logic is not usually possible. So that's why we have this paper. I think I'll come into next slide. There are, now here is another interesting. So degrees of relatedness and relevance. So people have, you look at the literature, people have used the words semantic similarity, semantic proximity, semantic distance. Try to interpret this. Are they same? Are they different? Unless you look at the definition, you can't tell. Right? And here is an interesting thing. For every time, you could possibly say that two things are the same or equivalent. And by the way, same, you know, you really are often not saying. So when you say same as, unless you use additional vocabulary, I don't know whether SCoS can help you there or not. But same in what context? Right? So the example of switch I gave was that they may be same in one context versus not. Same in physical but not logical. Logical but not physical. Right? So to be accurate, you'll have to say same as in this context. So in the semantic proximity measure that I defined in year 1992, I had context as a, so it was a n tuple with context as one of the tuple, representation choice
domain.
domain as one of the tuple and context. So but then when you go for everything that you might be able to say in the life to be equal, there'll be 10 or 100 things that will be related but not equal. Equal is very strong, right? And potentially, likely, if you want, you can formally define and assert equivalence. But the moment you say it's not exactly the same, it's about the same. Now you have to model about. And that is very difficult for people to agree on what that about is. Right? So, there is differentiation, disjointness. Then comes the concept of related in a context.
So I mean, if you don't take it and at a level of abstraction, it's going to be so complex. Like the one that you said about that problem of Tim Berners-Lee, he wants to visit somebody and then they started representing all of the complexities of this problem.
Yes. Now, here is an important thing to realize. So all these, so my philosophy, okay, which I am sure logicians would disagree with, he said, I would take this in the context of the application for what my needs are. Right? So if you have a particular context, in that context, it may be perfectly fine when you treat 0.99 as 1. And you go on with it. That will not be acceptable to formal person. And hence, for them, the problem, solving the problem, they get into the weeds to solve the problem. But it is, solving the problem becomes so hard that practically it is not useful. Right? So, you could, this other term, semantic ambiguity. When the information or the knowledge is incomplete, inconsistent, or approximate. These are very important terms, or uncertain also. Right? And, here is that what I was saying. Even easily involves different notions of identity, unity, essence. There is a good paper by Guarino and Veltier. And there is a more detailed treatment of this into the paper that I would like at least the PhD students to read, Semantics for the Semantic Web, the Implicit, the Formal, and the Powerful. Right? And it is very clear that the Semantic Web standards only deal with this, one type of semantics, one aspect of semantics. Now, so I always had this, approach. In the implicit, what am I doing? What am I saying? Implicit is this where I may have statistical, notion of things being same enough, right? Related enough. And that is very important. So what happened in early years of semantic web is that people were previous. They were driven by description logic people. And they were trying to come, say we can solve complex problem, and they never did. And meanwhile, Google's and everybody working on machine learning and data mining progressed much faster, at least in the form that they could process a lot of data for a given application. While semantic web for many years, at least until 2005, maybe even beyond, didn't achieve anything significant. Only after they started to, deal with logical forms. So one guy who is very well known in the field is Jim Handler, and he did a very interesting observation of little semantics goes a long way. Right. So that is a rather well-known kind of statement. That was very useful. He used just the right word to express what I also believed in and practiced, in fact, in our own company. Right. So,
excuse me. I have a question. For the semantic ambiguity, my current project, I want to make sure that I can call it semantic ambiguity actually. So I labeled MG, for example. So that's, I call it, let's say this is semantic labeling, and I refer MG, it's marijuana. Then, because in my lexicon I had Mary Jane as a marijuana, also one term. So when I collected data, actually I had labeled MG to drug as a lexicon, but I collected all two types. So can we call that is semantic ambiguity? Because I collected marijuana and I collected Mary Jane as well. So both of them. So one labeling, it was semantic labeling for drug and my only marijuana, but because Mary Jane also was inside the lexicon my list, so both of them came.
No, I think you are dealing with ambiguity, but semantic ambiguity implies when two things are not the same meaning. While in your case, two things have the same meaning but
different
syntax.
Terms, yes.
So it's opposite of any way of semantic ambiguity. So I'm not sure you want to use the word semantic ambiguity for that particular thing. You are using semantics to resolve ambiguity. If you're using some techniques to say the Mary Jane is same as marijuana, then you are using semantics to resolve ambiguity, but you don't.
But you don't have
semantic ambiguity anymore once you resolve that. So now some of the early work that we did, where relationship played very key role. I think my PhD students should understand this reasonably well. So the first thing was info harness and then visuals. And by the way, you can find the links and be worth browsing. So what happened was that this created facet search. This is I think I might have mentioned this is the first project that I did on the web. Remember web only came about in around, first it was defined only in 1990, technically 89, but he got permission to build in 1990. In late 1990, he implemented first World Wide Web server. And then he had a browser called World Wide Web browser. And that browser was not very useful, very, rigid and limited. In 1993, came with Mozilla that became Netscape. That was a useful browser. That showed the power of web. Same year, we started the project InfoHarness, where the idea was to take data or objects, get the metadata, and index, and then provide search using the metadata on the web. So, both the use of web metadata, as in not just the indexing of keywords, but use of metadata for heterogeneous content, that was novel relatively. For unstructured data, was novel. There was a lot of work on structured data beforehand, including some work that I did in the 80s and number of other people in the 80s on multi-data system. We did that. And then doing it in the web context with a browser based thing. So this is web search, not only search, but faceted search in the first year the browser came out, real useful browser. That's very early. Then we did InfoQuil. So you can see an interesting picture here. This is the picture that we came up with. And you can see the data of different modality, different databases and of different modality, meaning web images, video, text, everything like web pages, and relation databases, and then you have metadata, okay, and you have ontologies. Okay. Now this picture was made in 1996. Okay, so keep that in context. I'm not talking about 2006, 20 years before today, right? Where we talked about use of ontology. And this date is before the word semantic web came into picture, right? So the use of ontology did not start with semantic web. It's we have used it in 1992. Gruber, whose definition is most known, I believe his dissertation was published in 1991, I believe, if I remember correctly, okay, from KR Group, a very well-known, you know, Stanford's KR Group has been a powerhouse in this knowledge representation. They did a lot of work on so-called frame-based systems, knowledge representation. And in 1992, in defining semantic proximity, relationship across different data objects, heterogeneous data objects, we use ontologies. Okay. And again, this is for data of variety kinds, but in 1990,
so Tom Gruber finished his PhD in 88.
Oh, 88? Okay. Right. So then it was, there was more time than I thought it, there was between his thesis and but the, to my knowledge, the use of ontologies for integration of heterogeneous data came in 1992, 93, 94. There was another concurrent project from ISI, the Research Institute associated with USC, University of Southern California, where they were working on a project of using ontology for integrating data. I think we are 1 or 2 years ahead of you. Yeah, you were saying? So then came MREF. MREF is the idea which I thought I had a brilliant idea, but it never made into the world that you know, that I thought it should. So the idea is the following. Instead of HREF, which is the fundamental thing about link on the web, right? Well, link on the web is fundamental, right? But what makes web very powerful? One is that any data on a server is accessible in any browser. That is very powerful thing, right? Only before that, you have client and server, and you have to send data from server to client and all that stuff, right? There was a lot of song and dance to get the data. And you did not, you know, unless you use some standard, there was a rigid, you know, very hard to use standard called ORD, CORBA. You know, CORBA was the technology before, you know, web became popular. But you had to write containers and this and that kind of thing. So, but it was client-server kind of mindset. Then came the web. And the funda- so one is that the data is accessible for any browser. The second thing is that is the link. You go from any object to another object by clicking the link. Right? And then other things came. So the MREF says, you know, the link is dumb. AHREF is dumb. Only thing, what do you know? What can you have about AHREF? Well, a link is put on some words, some phrase, and that is a textual description, right? This link will give you more detail. You will write that. Well, what does it say? Well, to a software, it will read, this link will give you more details. That doesn't say much at all. About what? What is it giving more information about? Why should I follow this link? And not for a human reading it, right? For a human reading it, human would read the whole sentence and the entire context around that. So a human would know what detail, you know, this may be provided, right? But for a software, what, how would it know anything?
I think part of page rank, they take the anchor text.
Anchor text is this link will provide more detail. What does it tell you? Nothing. Okay. Well, anchor text, you know, for example, when Google started using it, they started doing more than what that. They started looking into the some basic metadata from the document being cited, connected to, and other things. So, I said, you know, let us associate metadata on AHREF. And so I call that MREF, M for metadata, metadata reference link. So I would say, I'll give, instead of the label only, you know, anchor text, I would give you metadata describing the contextual reason for connecting to this document. So I will tell you some metadata about the document as an example, if you don't give anything else. Right? It's a very powerful concept. Still, it's not found. And, you know, some of these things is just lucky because this idea I gave to Selvam. So Selvam is one of my most successful students. He heads the Allen Institute's technology effort for humanitarian work. And his job was to write an agent that could index the web pages utilizing this metadata. Or first creating the metadata automatically by reading the page referred to. But that's one master's in those days, and my master's student also didn't have that high bar. Even today, my master's has a lot more bar. So there's only so much we did, and after that, I never found a student that utilized this very powerful concept. Even today, I feel if you had, think about it, today, even today's web, suppose you had a software that would convert all the anchor text into contextually, structured representation, metadata, about why there is this link from here to there. That would be very powerful. And then you utilize in search, browsing, whatever else you want to do. So now, if you could do that, and when you do metadata, you could restrict yourself to use of an ontology. So as ontology giving you the context, so you only represent the metadata about things that is of interest to your application. For example, I can do in the context of PubMed documents, I would potentially say, okay, let me do this MREF with using only my medical ontologies or my medical ontologies. So I will not have all the other junks, right? I'm only interested in medical concepts or biomedical or clinical concepts. So I would have all the metadata that are relevant to my application, let's say. And if you did that, that means you'll be able to browse things in much more meaningful way. For example, I can use metadata of your previous browse to decide which of the possible links are meaningful and give you the highlight in different colors, saying this is potentially more relevant document than that document. The metadata would be a structured database, meaning something as in linked, a snippet of linked open data, right? A snippet of DBpedia, as an example, snippet of, so that is a very powerful concept you could have done, right?
Can you take that also, since right now the page is enriched with IDFA add annotation, so lots of tags, lots of triples, and entities embedded.
That's true. Sahita, this is a very good thing. So, this thing is way, way before RDFA and other things, right? So, there have come about some ways to associate metadata. But now again, RDFA is associated with a document, right?
Yes.
How have you seen anything that they associate with actually just a link at a time?
What?
Sorry. Individual HRF links?
I don't guess your question again.
Typically, RDFA is associated with, let's say, web page.
Yes.
I'm talking about associating thing with individual links. Remember, the MREF came from HREF. HREF is a link. There's an anchor text link going to other document.
Yes, but still you can define that this link as a triple, this link has this entity, this link contains this entity.
So only partially. So let me tell you my interpretation. So I have a document, then I have anchor text, and then I have a link to other page, right?
Yeah.
RDFA could be associated with that page.
Yes.
But I have, let's say, two links from this document and that document, and both of them have different reasons.
That's a vocabulary can't actually these guys working on can't NIF. NLP for exchange format. So for each document, it indexes all the characters in this document And for a particular anchor point, you say can say these particular text start from this index to from this is associated with to this concept. For example, you can link to the other entities. You can provide more metadata for this part of anchor point. Actually,
is it applied specifically on href?
You mean to define for that particular hyperlink?
So that is the MRF idea. What you're saying is that yes, I'm talking about 1996 to 1998, but yes, in sometime in late 2000s, we worked on RDFA and various other things, even SSN. You know, we have the links there, and we'll come to that. There's a lot more things that have gone on since these slides itself. That was done in 2008, and the work that was done decade before that. The Observer 1996 was the first project that talked about multi-ontology query processing. So, and again, let's just focus on the relationship aspects of it. So, we said, well, here is a consumer of information that writes a query. So, I will interpret the query in the context of some vocabulary or some ontology. But the data that needs to be accessed may have used another one. There's no reason to believe that the vocabulary content user uses is the same as the vocabulary of database, or content developer. So obviously both of them have different vocabularies. So you have to take query represented in one ontology onto the queries across multiple databases or data sets, each representing their respective ontologies. So how do you formulate the queries? How do you transform? Suppose the query asks for graduate student, but the database has students, including graduate students and undergraduate students. Now you can get only a superset of the data. So you can get, you'll have a good recall but poor precision, right? So that is what the Observer is about. So it's very interesting use of multiple ontology, different ontologies, and then being able to transform the queries. One concept that I want to mention, which because I think subsequent students have come across the need to do the same thing, but we are not well aware of, is the concept of information loss. So, when you transform query from one ontology or one concept to another, and you don't get exactly what is, because not everything is going to be same as or equivalence, right? So suppose you substitute some term by supertype or subtype, hyponame or hypername. Then you're not giving exactly what was asked for. So how do I capture and tell you I'm giving you an approximate answer? I'm giving you the best answer that is possible, but it's not the same as what you asked for. So modeling of that concept, and we define that based on both explicit and implicit information. So intentional and extensional information. So on schema level and on the instance data level. So there are two definitions for information loss. Then we of course did the TALI semantic search, directory semantic freedom and all that, and you are aware of that to some extent. So InfoQuilt was using metadata patch quilt and user models or ontologies to support queries and analytics over globally distributed heterogeneous media repositories. So this is a rather powerful concept of relationship, going from physical link to relationships. So let us look at this thing. a scenic sunset at Lake Tahoe. Right, that's the title. And then Lake Tahoe is a popular tourist spot. And there's some link, right, to laketahoe.txt. Some interesting facts are available here. So that link gives you some interesting facts. Maybe there's a list of things about Lake Tahoe. The scenic beauty of Lake Tahoe can be viewed in this photograph. And then there is a link to an image. So traditionally, correlation is achieved by using physical links done manually by users publishing HTML document. We wanted to create logical, document in a way, or logical web, not physical web. And so through what we call media independent metadata based on correlations. And so here is Ahref document description, physical link between documents, okay? And then MREF, list of keywords. I forget now exactly how we use threshold. Some way to interpret, this metadata, because you may want to limit, how much information you want to get from the target document, and then document description, or a MREF attributes, meaning you can associate keywords with this link, or some property in property values with them, right? So this example is interesting. Some interesting information on dams is available here. Information on dams, which is that link, is defined by MREF to keywords and metadata that may be useful for query. So now query can utilize the metadata that is on this link. Metadata gives logical, that from physical link to logical link. So here you have this image, and here, major components, it's a major component is RGB blue. And here is metadata, where it is content dependent metadata. So it may be height, width, and size of the image. Right? So some, additional metadata is available here. And this is how, this is a picture from, I think, 1998 paper, where we gave a syntax for defining MREF in RDF. So you have data, you have metadata, and you have this ontology or namespaces. And then you can describe the content. This is how the logical, model for logical correlations using ontological in terms.
Why we have two different metadata and data figures? So is it different or is it one type data?
Which one here?
No. One slide. Here. So is it different metadata?
No, for the data you have metadata. For example, so this GIF is a metadata.
Yeah. Are the data different?
And this other thing is metadata. So I'm providing representation of that metadata, and RDF has been a good one alternative of representing So we define MREF in RDF, and there is an example RDF RDF model for MREF. This is an example representation of that.
The metadata of that image, you said the dimensions of that image, right? So one of the ideas of MREF is to, for example, plan storage if you want to call all of this data. Why is this metadata is important for that image?
Yeah, because there are many things you can do, right? So you can say, give me the image of only this fidelity, this sharpness. Don't give me very poor images, as an example. Let's say. It can be anything for that matter. It can be anything. I'm just giving you a picture in metadata, which is its easiest thing. But it can be domain dependent also, content dependent metadata also. So here is a syntax for metadata. But this is more, now I'll give you more interesting example. Domain specific correlation. So here is what, any user, let's say a realtor, right? and realtor would get some page like this. Potential location for future shopping mall identified by all regions having a population greater than 500 and area greater than 50 square meters having an urban land cover and moderate relief. Right? That is the application. And then you are defining that using MRF, where MRF attributes population less than that, area less than that, region type equal to block, land cover type urban, relief equal to moderate, can be viewed here. Right? So, here, can be viewed, like when you click that, what you are doing is, you are executing this query, defined as MRF.
Oh, this is RESTful API. Is it RESTful code? Maybe
this is before REST and all that.
I know, I'm just saying, like, does it map to this?
You could, in the modern way, but understand something more. So let's look at the next couple of slides and see if that answers it, right? So, here what's happening? Your media, I'm interested in conveying that, whole space of the, world of relationships. That's my current purpose, right? So, just try to limit to that primarily, otherwise we'll never complete this out. Media independent relationship between domain specific and like population, area, land cover, relief. The earlier was media specific thing like height and whatever things about the image itself you're saying. And then there is correlation between image and structured data at a higher domain specific level as opposed to physical link chases in the world wide web. So let's try to understand how did this query get executed. So in reality, then that page was when you clicked on that link, what happened was that it actually got data from these three different places. Region came from this SQL, boundaries came from this Tiger Line database, and image features came for image processing routines that were applied on image features to get it came from a map database. And there are domain specific concepts like population, area, land cover, and relief. And there are, so they are concepts that are in this land management domain or real estate domain. So when you click that, this is what you got in those days. And it so happened that this is the result of that particular land block, which meets all the criteria, having performed all these things. Okay. So then there may be complex relationships where some relationships may not be manual asset, but according to statistical analysis of textual data or experimental data and so on, so forth, you can describe them. So allow association of provenance data with classes, instances, relationship type, and direct relationship or statements. So sometimes the relations are not always simple mathematical or string transformation. Semantic associations, which Temaphore defined in 2002 in the semantic web data context, and path within the classes. So this is how, this is an example of association. So it's a reviewer, it's an author of a, paper. And person, I don't now even remember exactly what specific relationship this talks about. I'll have an example later on. Okay. So there can be relationship as a graph based form fitting functions. There may be probabilistic relationship, probabilistic relational relationship. For example, smoking and cancer, is that a simple relationship? And the answer is not. In fact, what may happen is when you talk about smoking and cancer, there are a lot of different things that you are looking at in terms of, different features that you find, different correlations you can find. and you know, all these things, you know, for example, you study in clinical and biological sciences about trying to find from the data that, you know, improve the, it's not a single thing, right? There are a lot of different issues involved, and how, you know, direct smoker, secondary smoker, frequency of smoking, genomic composition, so many other things that are there, but they all, you know, I can't read this diagram anymore. Maybe this is easier to see. Here is a cause-effect relationship and knowledge discovery. So here, you have you know, at a high level, we can say, as humans, volcano affects environment. Okay? But in reality, it comes down to location being close, pyroclastic flow, you know, that can kill the people, ash rain that destroys building, weather, you know, and you know, so on and so forth, right? So there are many components of that. So high level relationship, a complex relationship with all the thing below that. These kind of stuff have received very little attention in research. Here is an interesting example. And I think this is an example that I love this example because it kind of, you know, often in computer science we tend to make problem much more simpler, but in real world the problem will be a lot more complex. So this was a case where there was a hypothesis, so people felt that you know, people empirically observed that whenever you used whenever you did nuclear test, there were some earthquakes. More recently, the same thing has appeared. When you do fracking, there are some earthquakes. Right?
What is fracking?
They go and you know, make drilling of certain kind to get the gas and oil by horizontal fracking. So this is the way America has been able to produce a lot of gas now, right? It's not through the normal putting the drill the thing and from the pipes suck out the oil. It's not that way. So you have to actually kill, you know, reaching that thing is not a reservoir, and it, you know, it's a lot more complex than that. And that is how, you know, but that process pumps a lot of water at high intensity with chemicals. And that water, you know, affects, it goes into geological areas of something that cause earthquakes. But these things are pretty complex, right? So here, the data for your earthquake sources, your nuclear test sources, and your published articles. And the published article says, nuclear tests may cause earthquake. Then how do we implement this scientifically? How do we compute this scientifically? Is it true? So to do that then, you know, you model that, what do you may cause? And then, your probability relationships, and you might find that number of earthquakes with magnitude over 7 is almost constant, meaning there's no impact of nuclear attacks and earthquake. But, you know, for earthquakes, smaller earthquakes, there appears to be higher frequency. And, you know, you may find out, you know, this kind of data. Right? So this is not a simple relationship, right? So then you come up with the thing, you know, so, you know, each research group earthquake magnitude in ranges 5.8 to 6, 6.7 to 7, blah, 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 on scale per, you know, year, then number of earthquakes. And then you find, oh, it probably only causes earthquake with magnitude less than 7. And then there's a lot more, saying nuclear tests could have caused an earthquake if the earthquake occurred sometime after the nuclear test was conducted in a nearby region. Now what nearby should be as a reasonable thing? And sometime after, what is it? One second after, 1 millisecond after, or 1 day after, 1 month after? So you have to model that kind of stuff. But what I'm saying is just look at the complexity of relationship here. And then comes entity extraction, entity relationship, event extraction, semantic annotation, all these things. So from content with structure like web pages, deep web, from well-formed text edited for rule of grammar, informal and causal, you know, casual text, social networking sites, from digital media, right? So from all kind of variety of data, this thing you are well aware of, right? Semantic meta, semantic structure, and structure sources. So this, you know, you have seen this one also, right? So all these kind of data you develop, extraction, you have seen this picture here, right? So I'm going to bypass this kind of stuff. This, by the way, I think may not have shown in research enrichment. So here, you look this, Phillips Petroleum, Shell. And here, what happens here? I have an ontologies and then I have, you know, where this is an oil company, and then I have instances of oil companies, Shell, Phillips Petroleum and Shell. So I know with additional data that this is a, you know, Phillips, Phillips is not the Phillips Electronics, but Phillips Petroleum, right? So it's very important. Human will immediately find you're talking about petroleum. But, you know, you give the text Phillips, well, Phillips could be whatever. Phillips crude driver. And then what happens here is that, so we enrich, you know, content enhancement using rich semantic meta tagging. So there are two ways of doing it, right? One is what the metadata do you extract or create can be embedded right in the document itself, or it is kept separately and linked to the document. Those are the options you have. And then once you find this out, you do value-added relevant metadata. So you look at the ontology and say, oh, I know for sure this is the case. For example, I may add, I found Phillips Petroleum, a type of company, is an oil and gas company. And I will add that, interesting, right? Metadata into this. So I guess one way is to add the metadata right to the document and make the document richer. Other is to link. Entity linking, you might say. So you link in SSN also, semantic sensor networking, also there is a linking, right, from sensor data to SSN ontology. And so you can do that way too. Here, you have document, your content text like classific channel partners, e-business solutions. There's a classification going on here. So machine learning and statistical techniques, knowledge-based techniques. I think we looked at this before. And here you see there are all these semantic metadata that are being added. For example, you know, this is a Wipro group and they have following business solutions. And this is Cisco, it's a telecommunication company, sector is computer hardware or networking, executive is John Chamber, computer is Norton Network. Right. So, and much of this thing is coming from the ontologies there. So you're making the documents richer. Your syntactic metadata, like product, you know, because you can use regular expression other ways to simply pick out some parts of the document. Yes. Yes. Okay. So I will. So this is all classification things. You've seen this. So I'll end there.